Welcome to the final session of these two incredible days. In this session, we will have Rosalind Franklin, the niece of Dr. Rosalind Franklin, talk about continuing Rosalind Franklin's legacy, along with Wendy Roll, the new president of the Rosalind Franklin University at Chicago. Rosalind Franklin heads an executive coach company in California, and she is also on the board of directors of the Rosalind Franklin University. So without much ado, let's welcome Wendy Roll and Rosalind Franklin. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the introduction. And we're excited to be here. It's been a wonderful two-day program with excellent speakers. So we've been asked to talk about the legacy of Rosalind Franklin. And so when we've thought about this, she's got legacy in many ways. There's her legacy in science, but there's also the legacy of her personal characteristics and her professional characteristics. So I think we all are aware of her legacy in science, particularly relevant today when the first messenger RNA vaccines are being approved very soon. But also remember that Dr. Franklin was the first person to establish the structure of a virus, and she worked in coal as well. In fact, one of the coal researchers said, "I considered her a genius," and I don't use that word lightly. She was so young and she was so brilliant. So she leaves a legacy of scientific discoveries, probably one of 20th century greatest scientific achievement, and that is elucidating the structure of DNA. But her professional characteristics really live on through her character. As a scientist, we know she was dedicated. She was a hard worker. She had attention to detail. And you could say that she was a perfectionist because photo 51 is really a photo of perfection. And in fact, on our university website, we say her pursuit of extreme clarity and her unflinching commitment to the higher standards of scientific researcher make her an ideal role model for our students and our faculty. But Rosalind knows more about her personal characteristics as a family member. And so I think she can share that as a legacy for Rosalind.
Thanks, Wendy. And I'm so thrilled to be doing this with you, president of the university, of which I'm honored to serve as a trustee. And thank you to the Rosalind Franklin Society for being the Rosalind Franklin Society and for including us in this very special occasion, this incredible two-day conference, as well as Rosalind's centennial anniversary. And so there's the wonderful recognition of the work that she's achieved. And I think Dr. Rose said, you know, a couple of things. Number one, that there's a whole, there's much more holistic picture to Rosalind that we can read about. And that's what I try to bring to the fore. People can always read in a book about somebody's achievements and the scientific rigor that she, which she did her work. But there really, Rosalind was a full human being beyond the scientist, which gets very little attention. And so I hope to bring her to life in a way. I was born 2 years after Rosalind's passing. My mother was very close to her. And I was honored, therefore, to be named after her. They used to go regularly to the theater every week. She came to live with us, actually, for 2 years prior to her death because the noise and the family's environment was a distraction for her when she was very ill. So when she was out of the hospital, she lived with us. But she was an incredible human being beyond being an incredible scientist. She was an alpinist. She was a mycologist. She was a favorite aunt, a beloved sister, daughter, friend. And these are the things that I don't think we read so much about. She was a terrible musician. We can read that. And some of the history, I think that's fun to see, you know, that you see some of the traits in young people that then come out later. I have school reports from her five-year-old kindergarten that talk about the way she wrote her numbers or the way she did her work with such precision. And you look back and think, how much of that was there when she was born? How much of those traits were carried through to be able to do this disciplined, rigorous sort of being a human computer later in life with dedication and commitment, unflailing in that sort of rigorous pursuit for the truth of whatever she was working on, whether it was to do a beautiful drawing or was to do a beautiful picture, as in the marvelous crystallography photograph 51 that she took, through, again, her own rigor of reconfiguring the machine to really get a phenomenal picture. So she really had so much more to her than we read, and I try and bring a little of that to life, because I think that sort of fully rounds out the magnificent woman that I'm honored to be named after.
What Rosalind, what does she tell us as women, and men too, in terms of how we should live our lives as scientists, but as a people? What would she say about how we should live our lives?
Oh, I'm not sure how we should live our lives. And you and I have talked a little bit about sort of what it is to be a woman scientist, what we deal with, but what is it to be a woman in the world? And we had a conversation then talking about sort of, we sort of broad brush everybody into women and men. Not all women have the narratives that was laid on top of Rosalind about being tough, difficult, and all the things that sort of come out in the literature we read about her. And men, some men struggle too in these arenas. But I think Rosalind was sort of unwavering. I think she knew what she wanted. During the war, her father wanted her to go into his war effort with him. And she knew that science was what she needed to stay with. That was the way she could contribute best, the way she sort of felt that the betterment for mankind could be done through the work she was doing. And I think that the little bit of what goes on today is we get pushed around. There's so much pressure, I think, on we got to go over here, we got to do this, and have you done this? And the results that sometimes staying the course with something, there's tremendous pressure building around us. And I think that's a remarkable attribute that she had, that she was actually sort of stayed the course, even though the conditions around her were difficult, even though she was a woman in science. But it's that discipline and being able to say, it's okay, don't have to bend to those around you who are encouraging you to go in different directions and think they can sort of push, to know to stay the course and stay true to yourself, to be doing what you believe is the right thing. And I think that's a challenge for people, and especially young people today, and in the environment we are in. So I'm sure, I don't know what you see, Wendy, in that.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at young people, sometimes they stay at a job for 2 years or 4 years and they're trying to get ahead and they don't sort of stay the course in that particular work environment. And I think she kind of gives us the legacy of sticking with something. Because there were many, many photos that she took that just weren't at the standard that she wanted them. She, as you said, had to jury-rig the machine to make sure that she could get a photo 51 that was perfect enough. And, we often, as women, also people say that we don't take risks. And I could say maybe she didn't take a risk, but I think she probably did. She got into some fields that women didn't traditionally go into. And she was looking at innovative things. So I would say that she took risks because, they always say, Sandberg has said from a report from Hewlett-Packard that men apply for a job when they think they have 60% of the requirements, whereas women only apply when they have 100%. It's not been demonstrated through research, but I think she probably was somebody that really took risks. It was risky in those days to go into the field that she went into and be a woman scientist. What are your thoughts on that, Rosalind?
I think also it's not in the risk taking, but I think as you said earlier, she wasn't defined by just DNA. That's what everybody knows about her. But she was doing significant, valuable research that lives on now and is useful today for the masks, the gas masks, and the war, and different times that we've used things from her previous work. And you even talked about the discerning of a structure of a virus. But so her narrative got formed by one moment in time. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an interesting consideration, because that's the picture that creates, yes, she'd made this extraordinary contribution to the discovery. But she knew she had the answer in front of her. Did she not take a leap because she was fearful of a risk? It was, is she a woman that just wanted to eliminate the A form because she knew the B form was the correct one and wanted to do the proof before she accepted it? Whereas would a man just have maybe taken a leap because he felt he had less risk? I don't have answers and I don't know that for sure. Yeah. She was a risk taker in her life. She would climb mountains. She would go down mountains in the dark on her skis when she didn't really ski very well. I mean, she would do a lot of things. So I don't think she was fearful. But there are things when you know that you want to prove yourself and you want a second chance, even if it's not for her, there may be another woman out there who doesn't take the risk because they're worried that, you know, we know in entrepreneurship today, and I know that you have an innovation speakers before us, that, you know, investments for women are harder, getting money for women is harder. So, you know, if you fail, do you worry that you may not get another opportunity? I don't know if that played any role at all, but she did doggedly pursue what she knew she had to and ended up with a rather remarkable result.
Yeah. Yeah. She definitely was a very strong woman, very intelligent woman. She's left us the legacy of working hard, of making sure that we are, you know, close to perfect and doing things the way we should do it. She took some risks in terms of the things that she did. One of the things that I think we need to always remember too is that women need to help other women. And she didn't have many women around her, right? And if you look at her colleagues, they were men. So that had to feel kind of isolating. And I think, one of the things that we can take away is that it was tough for her because there weren't women, and that we need as women to help other women, mentor them, because women can be the worst critics of other women, as we know. And so I think we take away the fact that it was tough on her and that we are in a different environment where we can mentor and help the next generation.
I think that it's, you know, we're thinking about women helping women. It was Anne Sayre who actually wrote the first book about Rosalind after the double helix and said, you know, you have not given her the right credit and due that she deserved, and wrote the book Rosalind Franklin by Anne Sayre that has gone on multiple books. And Brenda Maddox sort of wrote the most, I think, The Dark Lady of DNA was one. But she's been celebrated. And I think that, you know, I always say with Rosalind, she's standing on the shoulders of others that came before her. And that she's now celebrated and recognized. I think there's a rover going to Mars. I know there's a rover going to Mars in 2022 that bears her name. And it struck me when I went to see that rover and the fact that it has her name, but they've been working on that for about 20 years. And it reminded me of Rosalind's pursuit, just of sticking with something. You don't know what the result's going to be, but you believe in what you're doing. And her result gave this remarkable discovery, and what they did, what they've done and doing going to Mars will also, I hope, bear the same kind of discovery. But it takes a lot, it takes effort and stick-to-itness that I think is a great message in this is incredibly sort of quick changing and quick reward world that we live in, to encourage people that you don't have to flit around all the time. If you just stay what you're doing, the results can be there for you too. So I think that's a great message that she leaves for us.
I agree, Rosalind. I think it's a great message for a lot of young people. It really resonates with our university that's named after Rosalind Franklin. And we want our students to work hard to pursue excellence and to help each other and to put their ideas into practice that's going to help mankind. So I think she's left a wonderful legacy for all of us. And I'm just thrilled to be part of this conference along with Rosalind. And thank you for your attention. And I hope that we'll all remember Rosalind and the wonderful things that she's given us to think about in the future.
Thank you, Wendy. And I second that. I think the university is emblematic of that collaborative spirit and the interprofessional work that goes on at the university. That's the aspiration, to have a healthy environment in which to work and support each other to gain the results that would be beneficial to all. So thank you. It's been lovely doing this with you. And thank you to the Rosalind Franklin Society for having us here today.
Thank you.